Hi, I'm Mark Madison, the Fish and Wildlife Service historian at the National Conservation Training Center here in Shepherdstown, West Virginia. I want to welcome you back to another in our series of Conservationists in Action, where we do distance broadcasts and talk to scientists, writers, journalists about their work in the field and their new discoveries. Today we have a return guest. William Souder is back here at NCTC to talk about his most recent book, On a Farther Shore, The Life and Legacy of Rachel Carson. Welcome back.
Thanks, Mark. It's great to be back here. Fabulous place to visit.
It's great to have you back. We had Bill out here a number of years ago for his second book, Under a Wild Sky, about John James Audubon. And his book before that is familiar to a lot of biologists in the field. It was called A Plague of Frogs, about amphibian malformation. So it's perfect to have you back. And this is a nice culmination. And this book comes out on the 50th anniversary of Silent Spring.
It does. Silent Spring was published in September. On the 27th of September 1962, so we just passed the 50th anniversary. So Silent Spring is 50 years old, and by extension, you know, the modern environmental movement is a half a century old, because it really does begin with Rachel Carson and with Silent Spring. And I think that for the many people today who don't know who Rachel Carson is and have never read Silent Spring, they're kind of clueless about this big argument and debate that we continue to have about environmental matters. And this was something that really interested me a lot about Rachel Carson, and one of the reasons that I wrote the book. I wanted to explore this connection and take a look at what happened when Silent Spring was published, and then how that changed the way we think about the environment and our place in it. But yeah, five decades in, and here we are, still with a mess on our hands. Yeah.
Did your previous two books play in any way into this book?
Well, they did, because those are both books about science and environmental matters in many ways. Audubon, of course, was a lot of other things besides a naturalist, but he was kind of a ripping good story, a pioneer, a frontiersman, and a bit of a character. So my interests are nature, environment, science, history of those things. And in Rachel Carson, you have this really terrific story that coalesces around all those issues, because she was a writer and she was a scientist, and much of her work was about the natural world. And then, of course, eventually in her final book, Silent Spring, it's about the environmental interface between people and the natural world. So she was a real logical topic for me, and a really fascinating one.
Let's start at the end, because that's where your book starts.
Okay.
Your book opens up with President John Kennedy referencing Miss Carson's book, as he referred to it. Why was a book that's really about chemistry, bioaccumulation, so popular in 1962?
You know, I think there's a few different reasons for that. One is that, and it's hard for people who don't know Rachel Carson to understand this now, but she was in 1962, Rachel Carson was a very, very famous person. She was one of the most celebrated and beloved authors in America, and her three previous books had gained her a very wide audience. So there was going to be a natural interest in anything that Rachel Carson wrote or said. Because Silent Spring is such a departure from the books she'd written, her first three books are all about the ocean.
Right.
And these are lyrical natural histories of the ocean that incorporate all of the latest in oceanographic knowledge in a very accessible way. This was Carson's great talent, was translating science into prose that a lay audience could appreciate and understand. And so these books are really besotted with life. They're about evolution, they're about biology, and they're about the miraculous polymerization of the chemistry that gives rise to everything in the ocean, which Carson considered to be sort of the cradle of life. And so these books were always said to be poetic, lyrical, lovely, entertaining. And Silent Spring, of course, is a disturbing book. Yeah. This is a much more dire story. This is the story of pesticides and how they were contaminating the what Carson called the total environment, mm-hmm. Which was kind of a new concept.
Yeah.
The idea of ecology had been developing throughout the 20th century and was a well-understood scientific principle. But to the public, the idea that there was a global environment, a global ecosystem that could be universally contaminated was a novel concept, a novel idea. But Carson had seen this happening for a couple of decades at least, and with the use of pesticides that really came into wide use after World War II. This starts with DDT, dichlorodiphenyl trichloroethane. which is a compound that was synthesized in the 1870s. And nobody ever found a good use for it until 1939, when a Swiss chemist named Paul Muller discovered that it was a very potent insecticide that appeared to be harmless to warm-blooded species. So it was thought that this was going to be the magic bullet that could be used against insects that destroyed crops, forest lands, but more importantly, that transmitted human disease. So mm-hmm. disease vectors for typhus and malaria, these are insect-borne diseases. And Paul Muller ended up winning a Nobel Prize
right.
for discovering DDT. And DDT was widely used in World War II. By the Allies. We certainly used a lot of it in theaters of operation where U.S. troops were involved and where refugees were coming out of the eastern zones. It was tremendously effective. In 1943, the U.S. Army halted a typhus epidemic in Naples, Italy by spraying a million citizens with DDT. Wow. Apparently didn't kill any of the citizens and did stop the epidemic sort of in its tracks. After World War II, DDT and a host of related insecticides that were built on the, sort of the same chemical backbone really came into wide use and were deployed commercially, residentially. They were in use everywhere. And Carson was very, very concerned about this. She felt that this was an example of heedless technology, of deploying what the latest thing that came out of the engineering lab, the chemical lab, in an effort to control nature and to regulate it in our interests. She was not opposed to the idea of interfering with nature in our interests, but she was very concerned about doing this without any consideration for the collateral damage that might occur as a result of using these compounds. And as it turned out, there was quite a bit of collateral damage.
Yeah. We've been talking about Silent Spring, and here at NCTC we have an archive, and Carson worked for us for a number of years, and we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's covered well in your book. But I thought it'd be fun to bring up some objects that you've
sure.
been talking about. And one of the things we have is a first edition of Silent Spring. And this is kind of fun. Bill, you'll get a kick out of this. And I don't know if I showed it to you last time you were here, but it is a first edition of Silent Spring. So this is a book that you argue convincingly helped kick off the modern environmental movement with mm-hmm. its concerns and kind of a change in focus perhaps in the earlier conservation movement.
Yeah.
And it's signed by Carson. That's kind of fun.
Oh, that's neat.
But what I really like, it's signed to somebody named Hedley Donahoe. We have no idea who this was. But inside, it actually turned out to be signed twice. She wrote a chatty little note to Mr. Donahoe. Returning a dollar bill. Obviously, he'd sent her a book with return postage and asked Carson to sign it. And Carson went to the trouble of writing this note, signing it, and returning the dollar bill. I think it gives a nice indication of Carson being interesting.
This is kind of classic.
Here. We'll put this.
This is classic Rachel Carson. She did this all the time. When she became famous, which actually happened in 1951
yeah.
with a book called The Sea Around Us, and she was inundated with requests to give speeches, to do appearances, to talk to people, to give interviews, and she said no to almost all of those. She was a perfectly capable public speaker, and she did
yeah.
do things from time to time, but she was a very private person, and so it was not unusual for some prestigious organization to send Carson a very formal invitation to do something for her to simply say no. And in fact, she said that so often that her publisher would just got in the habit of saying no on her behalf. But if a high school student wrote her a letter and said, I'm going to be in a debate later next week about the oceans and I yeah. want to talk about the sea around us, or I'm going to be defending Silent Spring in a class exercise next week, could you give me any thoughts about how to do that? She would write back long, long letters to these kids and take time and give them very careful advice. So she could be incredibly generous with people that just got a hold of her out of the blue. That was very much in her nature. So it would be just like her. This is probably somebody who read Silent Spring, sent her a copy of the book hoping she'd sign it, included postage, which
right.
she declined to accept. So that's very, very much in keeping with her. I want to go back, though. You asked earlier about John Kennedy.
Yeah.
Mentioning Silent Spring. So we should explain that before Silent Spring was a book, it was a series of magazine articles in the New Yorker magazine, which excerpted, it was written as a book, but the New Yorker published in three consecutive issues major portions of the book, as they had done with a couple of Carson's other books. And this happened in June of 1962. That's when the magazine hit the stand. So all through the summer and into the fall of 1962, and the time leading up to the publication of Silent Spring at the end of September, there was this building controversy about what was in Silent Spring. And this frankly shocking book from Rachel Carson that was so unlike anything she'd done before, and that again had this sort of disturbing, disconcerting message to it, that we were unwittingly contaminating the environment that we were embedded in and part of and not separate from. Again, these are all new ideas, but they were sinking in very quickly. And at the end of August, President Kennedy held a press conference. He held a lot of these. He'd been in office for about a year and a half, and I think in that same year and a half time period, President Obama had held three press conferences. Well, for Kennedy, this was number 48.
He liked his press conferences.
He liked his press conferences. And this was an interesting press conference. He was asked a number of questions that were not very detailed, but very general in nature, about this apparent increase in shipping traffic between the Soviet Union and Cuba. Nobody knew what this was, but again, this is the late summer of 1962. There's all these ships making their way down to Cuba, which of course will eventually precipitate the Cuban Missile Crisis in October, just weeks after Silent Spring is published. But toward the end of that news conference, somebody asked Kennedy a question about pesticides, and specifically whether the government was going to look into these claims. He didn't mention Carson by name, the questioner didn't, that DDT and other pesticides posed long-term problems for the environment. Was the government going to do anything about this? And Kennedy, of course, already knew about Silent Spring and about the controversy around it. And so in his answer, he said, yeah, we are going to do something about that, particularly in light of Ms. Carson's book. And that's all he had to say, Ms. Carson's book. Everybody knew that was Rachel Carson and that was Silent Spring. And in my book, I argue that press conference, that moment in time, is actually the beginning of the environmental movement. That really marks a change in the nature of the dialogue that we have about man and the natural world. And so it's a really watershed moment, a fault line, if you will, between two different ways of thinking about environmental matters.
Since you're at a place called the National Conservation Training Center, you make an argument in there. And once again, I'd like to remind folks that haven't read it, and most of you probably haven't. It just came out almost simultaneously with the 50th anniversary of Silent Spring, so it came out about a month or so ago.
That's right.
It's a great book, and it's very thoughtful. It's a biography, but also an intellectual history of the era. But to go back to what you're talking about, you're saying Carson kicked off an environmental movement.
Yep.
And to a certain extent, we can distinguish that from an earlier early American conservation movement.
Sure.
Tell us a little more, especially since you've worked on Audubon and so on, and what are the different problems being addressed or questions being asked or even foci with Carson?
So I do make a distinction in my book between conservationism and environmentalism, but these are just terms. These are words.
Sure.
But they're applicable in this context. What I wanted to do was separate two distinct historical periods and two distinct ways of thinking about the environment. In the first half of the 20th century, you have this blossoming conservation movement. And it begins with the interests of sportsmen, primarily, and the enactment of game laws, closed seasons, bag limits, that kind of stuff, the establishment of the wildlife refuge system, a lot of concern for maintaining resources. Similar things happening in forestry and water conservation. This is not a very controversial concept. I mean, there's always conflicting interests when you try to preserve things, but this was essentially a nonpartisan, non-controversial proposition. And the idea was that we've been given a lot. We have a bountiful country, and it's our responsibility to be good stewards to the environment, to conserve what we have, to pass it on to future generations so that the traditions of hunting and fishing and exploring the wilderness can be perpetuated forever. And this thinking really did dominate the first half of the 20th century. And Rachel Carson was one of the primary voices for that. She did a lot of work at the Fish and Wildlife Service. She originally worked for the Bureau of Fisheries, right, which got merged with the Biological Survey in 1940, and then she eventually became the editor-in-chief. She was an information specialist. She became the editor-in-chief of the Fish and Wildlife Service, and one of the things that she did, of course, was write about these developments in conservation that were happening with the wildlife refuge system and other things. And so she's very much a voice for conservationism. With Silent Spring, she then launches this sort of second phase of the 20th century and our relationship with the environment, which I call environmentalism. You could call it something else, but it's distinct from conservationism in that this is a much more dire message. This is a more urgent message, and it's a little more pessimistic. It's not nearly as non-controversial as conservationism is. It's immediately becomes a partisan issue, a kind of a right-left divide in which you have, you know, industrial interests on one side and scientific interests on the other side and government forces on one side and political ideologies on another. And so Silent Spring really does kick off or initiates this argument that we continue to have to this day, this right-left argument over environmental matters. And so these are two different phases of the same thing, two halves of the same walnut, if you will. But Carson is the fault line. She's the one with a foot in kind of both worlds.
So there's a pivot point.
It's a pivot point, an inflection point, a tipping point. Yeah. It's all of those things. And it really does happen in this narrow window of time in 1962, when Silent Spring is being published and people are absorbing for the first time the implications of what's in it.
Yeah. Tell us a little about the controversy around the book. You cover that very extensively in your book. Who were proponents for Silent Spring and who was arguing against it?
Well, there were proponents for Silent Spring. There were many, many private citizens who read the book were immediately alarmed about what was in it. They believed what Rachel Carson said. I think a fairly significant proportion of people that responded positively to Silent Spring were baby boomers, people who were coming of age in the 1960s. And I think part of the reason for that is that in making her argument that pesticides contaminated the total environment, Carson drew this very explicit parallel to radioactive fallout, which was pervasive through the 1950s and into the 1960s because of the nuclear testing that was being done primarily by the United States and the Soviet Union. But we had, in 1962, the year that Silent Spring is published, you have a nuclear test somewhere in the world every few days. And so there is significant contamination of the atmosphere of the total global environment by radioactive fallout. And young people who'd grown up sort of drilling for nuclear war and who understood the dangers of fallout, they were a very receptive audience for this, as I said, novel idea that another type of invisible but ubiquitous contaminant could be a problem for the total environment. So there was a very receptive audience for the book among the public. Now, there were other interests that were less receptive, and that was primarily the chemicals industry and agriculture, because these pesticides were so heavily used both by the government and by farmers. There was a lot at stake. It was a big multi-million dollar industry in a time when millions of dollars actually meant something. Yeah. And so the people who manufactured DDT and other pesticides immediately organized with one another and launched a very concerted effort to discredit Silent Spring and frankly to destroy Rachel Carson, or at least to destroy her credibility as a writer and as a scientist. This was a very aggressive, well-funded, well-thought-out campaign. It included fact sheets that would be distributed to the press and to other interested parties, sort of disputing point by point what Carson said in Silent Spring. There was a famous parody of Silent Spring called The Desolate Year. For people who haven't read Silent Spring, it begins with this frightening fable. The first chapter of the book kind of imagines a world that's been devastated by pesticides, and the birds are gone, and the fish have died, and the livestock is all sickened, and the people are as well. And there is this sort of eerie echo of what might happen after a nuclear war that you hear throughout this opening chapter. And one of the chemical manufacturers, the Monsanto Company, which had a big, widely distributed magazine, commissioned a parody of that opening chapter and called it The Desolate Year. And it was portrayed the flip side of that argument. What would happen if we didn't have pesticides to combat insects? And that parody imagined a world overrun, if you will, with locusts and other devastating vermin. Kind of an ugly, not very graceful attempt to parody Carson, but it was part of this concerted effort to limit the damage that the chemicals industry thought that Silent Spring was probably going to do to them.
You have a funny anecdote about Dr. White Stevens, too, going around debating her.
Yeah, there was this guy. He worked for American Cyanamid, I believe. And I don't know if he was a line scientist or if he was a guy that had scientific training who was basically the mouthpiece for American Cyanamid. He might even still be alive. Somebody recently mentioned him, and I'm not sure if he's still out there, but he might be. He was a very articulate and ferocious defender of DDT and other pesticides. He unfortunately looked a lot like Vincent Price, the horror
spitting
actor, under the dark horn-rimmed glasses, and he had this sort of English accent, and he tended to come off a little over-dramatic at times. But he was, an effective defender of the chemicals industry, and clearly was being paid to travel the country and give speeches and give talks or offer to debate people that wanted to take Carson's side. So he was one of her most visible and vocal critics. A bit of a character. He actually added quite a bit to the story, certainly from my perspective, because it's always great to have a villain in the piece. And he did have this sort of snidely whiplash effect on camera. But he wasn't alone. There were other people that were, including people from the government in the Department of Agriculture, in the Public Health Service, who were very guarded in their response to Silent Spring, very measured in their response, but their default position was to defend the use of pesticides because they had been economically effective and important in agriculture and in public health, and they were concerned that we not completely dismiss the idea of using these kinds of compounds to promote food production, to protect human health. And the irony, of course, is that Carson felt the same way.
Right.
She said explicitly in Silent Spring, and she was asked on numerous occasions, including before the United States Senate when she testified, whether she wanted to ban pesticides entirely. And she said, no, that's not what I'm arguing for. What I'm saying is we are overusing them. We're using them recklessly without any knowledge of what the consequences might be. And what we need to do is rein that in and take a look specifically at every situation and ask what the cost-benefit situation is and proceed in a much more measured way. I mean, this is a time when we're spraying whole forests with DDT to control gypsy moss or whatever beetle is a problem in a specific area. And, you can't disperse these compounds from airplanes with any precision at all. And it requires a fairly heavy dose to have the desired effect. And usually once you get up to that effective dose, then you're doing a lot of damage to other wildlife and contaminating whole ecosystems. You're killing off fish, you're killing off beneficial insects, you're devastating bird populations, and because many of these compounds lingered in the environment, either because they were chemically persistent, they just didn't break down very readily, or because they were fat soluble. They got stored in fat tissues and would then migrate up through food chains and be perpetuated species to species. And this was a problem with birds particularly, which often foraged on either insects or earthworms that were contaminated, that had body burdens of DDT. These mechanisms were not well understood when we started using synthetic pesticides, but the more we learned about how they operated in the environment, the more clear it became that it was impossible to limit their effects just to the targeted species, that they always did some other additional damage beyond that.
And the controversy goes on. Just a couple months ago, you wrote a piece for the online magazine Slate entitled Rachel Carson's Not Responsible for the Death of Millions in Africa.
What, yeah, don't tell that to the Cato Institute or any of the other right-wing think tanks that would have it otherwise. There actually is a website called rachelwaswrong.org for people who want to pursue this in detail. This is all based on the argument that in writing Silent Spring, Rachel Carson effectively did ban the use of DDT, did bring about an end to its use, and that one result of that was to extend the epidemic of malaria, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. And so the argument goes that Rachel Carson is responsible for the sickness and the deaths of millions of people in Africa because she ended the use of DDT. That's all simply not true. She, again, never wanted to ban any pesticide. She always made an exception for using them to preserve human health. She recognized that they were effective and even morally the responsible thing to do in combating diseases like typhus and malaria. So she never argued for that. And her book didn't even have that as an unintended consequence, because when the EPA was formed in 1970 and set about as one of its first orders of business to ban DDT and these other pesticides, that was only the domestic use. That was only their use in the United States. That ruling had no force of law anywhere else in the world. And in fact, DDT continued to be readily available throughout the world. We manufactured DDT in the United States until the mid-1980s and exported it. So it's always been available to be used. The fact is it was never being used very effectively or very widely in sub-Saharan Africa because that was a difficult environment to use it in. People lived in remote villages. There's poor infrastructure, poor road connections. This was not the kind of situation where DDT had been particularly effective, as it had been in places like the southern United States, southern Europe, northern Africa, southern Africa, parts of India. The World Health Organization actually had some big successes with DDT against malaria, but it had never been a particularly vital program in Africa. So not only did Rachel Carson not kill a lot of people in Africa, she didn't even help to initiate policies that had any profound impact there. And 2006, the World Health Organization decided to renew its efforts to use DDT against malaria in Africa, and that decision was endorsed by, I think has been endorsed by, virtually every major environmental group, certainly in this country and I think around the world. And I'm sure Rachel Carson would agree with that decision if she were with us today.
Let's shift gears a little.
Okay.
Your book spends an interesting amount of time looking at Silent Spring and the controversy and the context. You've alluded to radioactive fallout and the environmental movement, but also as a nice biography of Carson for people who, like you said, might not remember Rachel Carson's background and so on. So tell us a little about her earlier life.
Well, Rachel Carson was born near Pittsburgh, a little town called Springdale, which is on the Allegheny River, about 15 miles north of the city of Pittsburgh. She was born there in 1907. Lived kind of in the semi-country. Her father he held a variety of sort of part-time jobs in his life. His main hope for a career in life was that he wanted to develop some property that he owned in Springfield, and so he, you know, platted out and developed these residential lots that never sold very well. And as a result, the family was in poverty or near poverty for most of the time that Rachel was growing up. She was a very bright young woman, and she earned a scholarship to the Pennsylvania College for Women, which is a small, private, liberal arts women's college in Pittsburgh, so not very far away from home. Tiny, you know, only a few hundred students, but a good school and a place to get a good education. And she was one of the standout students at PCW,
Chatham.
It's now Chatham University in Pittsburgh. It's a wonderful place, and Carson went there planning to major in English. She had been very interested in writing even as a youngster. She'd published a couple of pieces in a children's magazine before she went off to college, and from a very early age she always felt that writing was her calling and that there was no more exalted title than author. And a bygone era.
I'm sure you agree.
Well, I'd like to agree. Times are changing, and I think authors are an endangered species along with books these days. But Carson, when she got to school, came under the influence of a biology professor there named Mary Scott Skinker, who was, by all accounts, the most glamorous and magnetic of the professors at PCW. And Skinker got Carson interested in biology. She didn't lobby for Carson to change her major, but Carson, on her own, decided to do that. Mm-hmm. And she ended up getting her degree in biology and then went off to study for her master's degree at Johns Hopkins University. Also spent some summers at Woods Hole at the Marine Biological Laboratory there doing field research. She did earn her master's degree in zoology from Johns Hopkins, but she did so just as the Depression was really taking hold. And because she was really kind of the only breadwinner in her family, she'd been teaching some biology courses. She was the only one really bringing in any income. Various members of her family were living with her at different times in and around Baltimore. And Carson decided not to pursue her doctorate and instead got a government job, which was, this was the safety net. This was the lifeboat in the early 1930s for a lot of people. The government was the only going concern that was hiring. And she got a job at the Bureau of Fisheries as, initially she was a freelancer, kind of a contract worker, and she worked on these radio scripts. Apparently the Bureau of Fisheries did little radio broadcasts every week through the CBS network to explain what was happening in the oceans and with fish stocks, and they needed somebody to write these scripts, and they hired her to do that, and she did a good job. And so she came on really as a full-time information specialist. And one of the early assignments that she got from her boss was to write, he asked her to write something of a general nature about the ocean. That was about as specific as the assignment was. And so she went off and spent a few weeks, and she wrote this really lovely, compelling essay that when she handed it to her boss, he read through it and said, We can't use this. This is way, way too good for government work. You should sell this to the Atlantic magazine. And she did. And so this article called Under Sea came out in 1937. And she was, excuse me, she was noticed by, I'm sorry. She was noticed by a book publisher, and Under Sea, that article in the Atlantic Monthly led to her first book, and that led to the second, and so on and so on. So she worked for the Fish and Wildlife Service through the 1940s, and then in 1951 she published her big, most successful book, The Sea Around Us, which was a huge international bestseller. It was on the New York Times bestseller list for many, many weeks, at the top of the list for about 39 weeks. It won the National Book Award. It really made her reputation as a writer, and it allowed her to leave government service. So
the lucrative field of government service.
The lucrative field of government service, which had been very, very, had been very good to her.
Yeah.
And it was very, and her work at the Fish and Wildlife Service is really important to her development as a writer, but also as a thinker about environmental matters, because so much of her work did concern conservation, and also the early toxicology studies that Fish and Wildlife Service was doing at Patuxent and other places like that. So
we've got a few objects from that era.
I bet you do.
Maybe to do some show and tell, and one of the things you talked about was a series that was fairly pioneering for the government in general, that Carson spearheaded, called Conservation in Action. Can you tell us a little about that?
Yeah, so this was a series of booklets. They're pamphlets. Some of them are fairly extensive. They're 50, 60 pages long. And I think there are 8 or 9 of them altogether, and I think Carson worked on 6 or 7 of them at least, and wrote entirely at least 4 or 5 of them. This was a series that Carson conceived, or helped to conceive, that was intended originally, I think, to help explain the National Wildlife Refuge System to people who use the refuges, but also to universities and extension services, people that were interested in conservation matters. And These were very ambitious publications. These are unlike most government publications in that they are beautifully written, elaborately. They're elaborate narratives about these refuges that explain the natural history of the refuge, the logic of why the refuge exists where it does, how it serves the interests of migrating waterfowl or whatever the local ecosystem is. They're extremely well done. They're beautifully illustrated. I guess you could get them for free if you showed up at a refuge and wanted to spend some time there. They also had, in many cases, the purpose of explaining to sportsmen why the government had grabbed a big piece of land and set it aside. And this was often a challenge. The Fish and Wildlife Service is the interface between the resource and the people who want to use the resource. Mm-hmm. And so a big part of Carson's job was explaining the logic of the Fish and Wildlife Service's policies and programs in this refuge system. These are really, really interesting. They're interesting period pieces. They're as lively and as beautiful to read today as they were when she was writing them in the mid-1940s primarily. One of the one installment of Conservation Action, number 5, was not about a specific wildlife refuge.
We have that one.
You have that here?
Is this the one you're going to talk about?
Guarding our wildlife resources.
General overview.
This was an overview. This was a sort of a summary statement about American conservationism. And in this book, rather than exploring a single wildlife refuge, what Carson did was to kind of go through the history of the American conservation movement, if you will, and document kind of ecosystem by ecosystem and species by species what had become by the 1930s and 1940s this sort of serial tragedy in which we started out with what seemed to be an inexhaustible resource that somehow got exhausted through over-harvest, through over-hunting, through habitat loss and modification. A story that's familiar to us now, but again, that was these were emerging concepts back in the 1940s. And in explaining what had happened, sort of case by case, Carson also explained what Fish and Wildlife Service was doing to address this problem and what conservationism could do to reverse some of these issues. Conservation Action Number 5, this one, comes out in 1948, and that's the same year that Aldo Leopold sells a book that he calls Great Possessions to a publisher in New York. Leopold gets word that the book's going to be published, and then he dies, helping a neighbor put out a fire near his shack in Baraboo, Wisconsin. So he never lives to see the book. But the book is published pretty much as Leopold wrote it, except that the publisher wants a different title, and so they agree with the Leopold family that they can retitle the book A Sand County Almanac, which now, of course, is one of the pillars of American conservationism. So 1948 is kind of a peak year, and both Carson and Aldo Leopold are articulating the state of affairs of American conservation and laying out a roadmap for the future. With Carson, it's a roadmap that runs through the National Wildlife Refuge System, through the Fish and Wildlife Service. With Leopold, it runs through an idea that he calls the land ethic. This idea that ecosystems are complex, interactive places, and that it's a mistake only to look at the species that have economic value, like a tree or a trout. And what you have to do is look at ecosystems in their totality and set aside the economic considerations and look at the moral considerations. And basically what Leopold says in the land ethic is that anything that you do that promotes the stability and diversity and sustainability of an ecosystem is a good thing to do. Anything else that is contrary to that is probably a bad thing to do. And so it's not that you can't do those kinds of things, but you need to consider the consequences. And so these two voices, Leopold and Carson, who, had they ever met, probably would have clashed because they had different views about certain things, again, really kind of bring American conservationism to a peak point in the late 1940s.
That's a good point. I've never seen that connection between 1948. And the other thing that comes out in your book is both are important popularizers of the new field of ecology, which isn't well known in America. Really, the first major university programs start in the 50s and on. And these guys are taking food chains, Charles Elton's work and so on, and both publicizing it in different ways for the public. So it's a really good book. Let's switch just a bit, but I've given you a teaser that the other thing that's covered in Bill's book very nicely is other authors in the era. Mm-hmm. Carson isn't writing in a vacuum. She isn't living in a vacuum. She's living in a world of books and authors that she's building off of. But I want to talk a little about Patuxent Refuge. Mm-hmm. And one of the striking things that comes out in the book is Silent Spring comes out in 1962. I think most people assume it's something she became interested in shortly before the book came out. But you did a very nice job of pushing this back at least to the mid-1940s and an interest early on, almost as soon as DDT started being used for civilian purposes as a potentially dangerous toxin. And we do have one object from that era, something you mentioned in the book. Carson, one of her functions besides writing publications was to write press releases. It was an important thing she did. And she started writing press releases on this as early as 1945. I think this is one of the earliest ones we have.
That's right.
And then wrote some more detailed press releases on the same subject the subsequent year.
Right.
So tell us a little what was happening at Patuxent. It was called Patuxent Research Refuge.
Had different names. And even now, if you go there, it depends on which,
which side you're in yes.
as to what they call it. So in 1943, the first 6 pounds of DDT arrived in America. We got it, I suppose, from Switzerland, what was being synthesized. And there were tests done on it by the Public Health Service and the Army, people who wanted to use it. And then it was immediately deployed into wartime use in Europe and in the Pacific. In 1945, the Fish and Wildlife Service decided to examine what happened if you used it on a wide scale. And so their initial experiments involved spraying DDT from airplanes over a section of the Patuxent facility in Maryland and then looking to see what happened. They also did some more controlled laboratory experiments, dosing experiments, where they could monitor control groups and also control exposure levels to see what effect DDT would have on other forms of wildlife. And right from the start, it was clear that it was very toxic to aquatic organisms. Fish, shellfish were very, very susceptible to DDT. They were easily killed by the overspray that would land on a river or a lake. It was less clear what was happening to other species, partly because they could disperse, partly because, again, when you spray something from an airplane, a lot of it comes down here, and hardly any of it comes down over here. And so there's going to be strips and holes in the application where animals and birds can escape to, or whether they simply don't get exposed. So it was a little bit. It took a while for the total picture to emerge, but by the late 1940s, there's a full-time biologist at Patuxent whose job is to work on DDT problems, because right from the start, it was clear in the technical papers coming out of Patuxent, it was clear in the press releases that Rachel Carson and other people were being asked to write, that there was a significant amount of collateral damage to other wildlife when DDT was used in a natural setting. And so she knew about this right from the start. In 1945, she actually proposed a story about DDT to the Reader's Digest. The Reader's Digest, somewhat foolishly in hindsight, said, no, that just doesn't sound very interesting. And they passed, and she sort of let the matter drop in terms of having an active interest of writing about it. But she continued to follow what was happening for all the years after that. And then through the course of the 1950s, as nuclear testing became a much bigger problem, and Carson began to see this kind of inescapable link between these two types of universal contamination, her interest was continued and renewed. She corresponded with lots of people about pesticide problems. One of the things that happened as a result of those studies by Fish and Wildlife was that the recommended rate for applying DDT was steadily reduced. They started out, I think, spraying about 5 pounds per acre, and by the mid-1950s, I think the recommended dose was down to a pound per acre. I don't even know how you measure a pound per acre, particularly if you're spraying it from an airplane, or if you are spraying an elm tree to kill the beetles that carry Dutch elm disease, as was done in a lot of places. You know, there was a certain amount of DDT that was said to be right for an elm tree, but how that calculates to an acre of dosage is very hard to know. And the reality in the field was that farmers and foresters always figured that if a little was good, more was probably even better. And so there was very little regulation. I mean, there were labels, but there was very little enforcement about how this stuff was used. And so 6 pounds come into the United States in 1943. By 1959, we're applying about 80 million tons of DDT in this country every year. And while that's happening, Carson is watching DDT and other pesticides getting incorporated into all kinds of products for both commercial and residential use. And, you know, shelf paper.
Yeah.
And
we have some of that in the archives.
I can remember my mom lining our kitchen shelves with shelf paper that was impregnated with insecticide. Yeah. I don't know if it was DDT, but it probably was. You could get these aerosol bombs that you could set off in a room and would fumigate a room in as little as 6 seconds and leave a tasty residue on the walls that would be effective for many months afterwards. One of my favorites was, and my dad had one of these, it was a canister of DDT that mounted onto the muffler of a lawnmower. And as you mowed the lawn, the hot exhaust would pass through the cell, it would volatilize the DDT and spray out a cloud of toxic insecticide over the lawn as you cut it. So if you're having a picnic or people over to grill out that night, you could prepare in that way. So all of this, the use of these compounds becomes so pervasive, so widespread, that it's an inescapable fact of life by the late 1950s. And then a group of residents in Long Island decided to sue the state of New York to see if they could stop them from flying airplanes over their property and spraying DDT for gypsy moths. And that lawsuit brought the story of pesticides back onto the top of Carson's to-do list. She wanted somebody else to write about it. She tried to get E.B. White at the New Yorker to write a story about this lawsuit, and he couldn't do it, but he said, you know, you should do it. And ultimately, that's what happened. That was the direct precipitator of Silent Spring.
So Charlotte's Web meets Silent Spring is what we missed.
Yes, E.B. White. E.B. White was a big fan of Carson's books, had been ever since the Ocean books were being serialized in the New Yorker. And of course, he was very concerned about pesticide use as well. He lived up in Maine, and these things were being sprayed up there as well. And so he shared Carson's concern and was eager to see her pursue the story. So she got a lot of encouragement from him.
Bill, this has been one of the fastest hours ever.
It can't be
but
done already.
We're just about, but I have one last question, and it's a question we have to ask, because you've chosen to write a new book about Carson, and that would be, you know, what's her legacy today? Besides the controversy and so on, are there any other legacies that she has?
Well, I do think, you know, besides the specific controversy that surrounded Silent Spring, again, I do think that the whole way that we discuss and talk about and argue out environmental matters is one of her legacies. She certainly has her most important legacy, I think, is that she caused us to understand that, in fact, we do have to be careful about what we do, and that we can damage the natural environment, that we can contaminate the total global ecosystem without exercising care over a lot of human activity. That's her primary legacy. But in addition to that, the criticisms that were directed at Silent Spring, the very political, partisan nature of the response to it, I think that's still very much with us today. And I think if you took Silent Spring and substituted out pesticides and put in climate change, you could see the argument unfold in just about the same way. The sides have aligned in exactly the same way that they did back then. And I think one of the things that would probably distress her the most is the resistance to science that is often part of that discussion. The unfounded assertion of either a political agenda or an ideology in favor of or in opposition to scientific data. Mm-hmm. She would find that kind of mystifying and really disturbing, and an indication that we didn't learn enough from Silent Spring.
Well, that's a great way to go out. The book is On a Farther Shore, The Life and Legacy of Rachel Carson. The author is William Souder, and I strongly recommend you read it and reread Silent Spring. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark.